From coast to coast and around the world, it's time to praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Let every nation rejoice. Praise the Lord with one mighty voice.
Praise the Lord covers the major Christian events in America and across the world. From the heart of Europe. The tip of Africa. From the centers of Asia. Central and South America.
You're a part of the world's largest prayer and praise gathering. Joining us from the International Production Center in Irving, Texas are Pastor Greater Bethany Community Church of Los Angeles, California, Bishop Noel Jones, Project Director Project 2000, launched by the Potter's House in Dallas, Texas, Nathaniel Tate, author and Chief Operating Officer for TD Jakes Enterprises, Curtis Wallace, Grammy-nominated gospel singer and songwriter, Beverly Crawford, anointed singer and recording artist, Shirley Murdoch. Ready to take your calls. Prayer partners around America. Your host, founder, and senior pastor of the Potter's House in Dallas, Texas, Bishop T.D. Jakes.
Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. This is the day. This is the day. Right now, today, this is absolutely the day that the Lord has made. We shall rejoice and be glad in it. We've got a wonderful lineup tonight. We're excited about everything that God is going to do. You need to get in a hurry and pick up the phone. Call all of your friends, your neighbors, your cousin, your auntie, your mama and them, everybody. We're going to have a great time in the Lord tonight. I feel it in my spirit and in my soul. Somebody's breakthrough is going to happen in this program today in Jesus' name. Now, you need to prepare yourself for a miracle in your heart and in your spirit and be encouraged. I know some of you have been through trials and you've been through tests. Maybe you had a hard day at work, drove through traffic, left the chicken at the chicken house and all that kind of stuff. But it's time for you to relax and prepare yourself for the best that God has for you. Did you not know that David said, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. You have to say it. My soul shall make her boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear thereof and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me and let us exalt his name together. We've got ministry for you tonight. We've got special ministry prepared for you. You're going to be blessed through the word of God. We're going to be challenging you and challenging pastors and church leaders how to develop your church, how to take your church to the next level, how to wolf-proof your sheep and your flock against all the things that the enemy would try to do. This is going to be a great night in the Lord, and we've got a special surprise guest that we haven't told anybody about tonight. It's going to be awesome. It's going to be great. But before we share that with them, I want to take a moment and pray for you. I want to pray for the program tonight. I want to pray with you that God would link us together in a supernatural way. Because when you and I touch and agree, powerful things begin to happen. Maybe you've been stressed out. Maybe you've been overwhelmed. Maybe you've dealt with demons and trouble and distress. And somebody's had some bad news today. But God is able. And as we pray today, can you believe God with me that God can bring the best out of a mess? Can you believe that God can do that tonight? Ah, yes. I believe that all things are possible to him that believes. Father, right now, in the name of Jesus, everybody praying, Father, we thank you for what you're about to do in this place tonight. We pray for Bishop Noel Jones that as he breaks the bread of life tonight, that somebody would be set free, that demons would be horrified tonight by the power of the word of God. We pray for each singer, Beverly Crawford, Shirley Murdoch. Let the anointing just fall on all of the interviews and all that we do tonight. We want you to be glorified. Remember that troubled soul that just flicked through the television set and ran on this station. Let the Spirit of God move in a supernatural way. That marriage that's in trouble and needing you so desperately, Holy Spirit, come in a flood. That person watching in the hospital room right now, the test results don't look good, but God, you're greater than the test, and you can bring a testimony out of that test. I thank you for what you're doing right now. We lift up before you Dr. E.K. Bailey. Lord, you've already done a great work. You're able to finish what you started. We lift him up before you right now in the name of Jesus. Back up every sickness, every disease, every trouble all over the world. We speak peace. Let the anointing and the presence of God move supernaturally. We wave New York before you. Father, you know right now how to move and touch and heal those that are hurting and need your touch right now. Let your grace take over this place tonight. Move in a supernatural way. We believe you for miracles in Jesus' name. Somebody shout amen. Amen. Now listen. You need to pick up your phones and call in. Let us know if the program's blessing you. The Praise-a-thon is still going on. There's still an opportunity for you to pledge and participate. This is a ministry worth supporting, and you couldn't have a ministry without a minister. You couldn't have a vision without a visionary. And guess who's here tonight? Paul and Jan are in the house. Come on, put your hands together and make them welcome. Come on, Paul and Jan, we love you. We thank God for you. We pray for you all the time. Bless your heart. Welcome.
How's my bishop tonight?
I'm blessed, brother.
I have one question first. God bless you all. Thank you. In fact, the reason Jan and I are here tonight is to just say a great big hearty thank you to all of you who called all the week of Praise-a-thon and blessed us. I've got a couple of exciting reports to give to you. But how do you, wolf, W-O-L-F, proof your sheep?
You know what? You do it with information. The more truth that they have, they're able to make better choices and better decisions. You shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free.
Ooh, you're going to talk about that a little bit tonight, aren't you?
Yes, sir.
Every pastor's ear ought to have perked up on that one just now. Well, yes, we just want to say hello for a few minutes and thank you, thank you, thank you. It was the greatest telethon we've ever had. More ministry than any other praise-a-thon, and the emails and the phone calls are pouring in from literally all over the world. Do you all want to shout a little bit right now? You know what? Boy, you brought the shouting ones tonight, didn't you? You know that the Taliban in Afghanistan has virtually fallen, and I saw on, yeah, praise God, and keep praying for our boys over there. Did you know? Everything is gone, and we have not taken one death in the whole campaign so far. God's hand is on our armed forces, brother. And we pray, need to pray that he'll keep it there. But one thing that just sent me through the roof as I snuck in late one night after Praise-a-thon was over, and I saw a special news report. And, you know, TV has been banned for 5 years over there. No TVs at all. And we found out that many of them had buried their TVs in the backyard, you know, under the dirt. And they're digging them up now and bringing them out. And I saw the little satellite shop is open, and they're starting to sell the little dishes all over Afghanistan again. And we got our first email from Afghanistan today. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
The ground troops are in there. Now here comes the Air Force in the form of Pilot T.D. Jakes. Oh boy, we're going to have...
Oh, yeah. The other day, I have to tell you something so cute, Pastor. The other day I was at one of the outlet malls here. I won't say which one, but it was incredible. And all of a sudden, this lady came running down the hall to me and almost attacked me. She says, "I have to thank you." I said, "For what?" She said, "You put my pastor on every morning on TBN, and she told me y'all are paying the airtime." And she was just jumping around.
That was one of your wolf-proof sheep.
That's right.
Yes.
You're shouting about it. We are so excited and so delighted that Daily Show, God is really, really blessing it. You like it? 7 o'clock in the morning, God is just blessing us and sending the word of God out in a supernatural way.
Central
time, yeah. And we're getting emails from all over everywhere, people being blessed. It's called the Potter's Touch. If you haven't checked it out, it's worth getting up in the morning. We're talking, we're dealing with issues, we're confronting issues, and people are being blessed. Marriages are being set free. Homes are being restored. Thank you for investing in our ministry, and through it, we're able to reach the world for Jesus Christ.
That is our joy, Bishop Jakes. We love it. And just keep preaching the word, and I'll keep building TV stations. Have we got a deal? All right. Speaking of that, because of you precious ones, we are sending 100 more receivers, 100 more stations are coming on in the Philippine Islands. Hello, Philippines. God bless you. Africa. The satellite receiver's on the way. Swaziland, the equipment's on the way. $13,000. Jan, she paid for that. Satellite dish that covers Ghana, West Africa, is all paid for. Namibia, South of Africa, $300,000 is in hand. Congo, a whole new TV station in Kinshasa, the capital city of Congo. It was Zaire for a while. Now it's Congo again. And it's going to have 24-hour day Christian television. Russia, translation equipment is on the way, just on and on and on. Every project has been
paid for
by you in Jesus' name. Oh, hallelujah. And TBN is still 100% out of debt. Hallelujah. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Let me just read you a couple of quick little, listen, from Dubai over in the United Arab Emirates. That's where Benny went, wasn't it? Had that great crusade over in Dubai. Said, "Dear Paul and Jane Crouch, I have something to tell you which is very powerful. My name is," and I never use names in that part of the world, "I'm staying here in Dubai. My dad is a pastor. My mom a strong believer. We as a church in Dubai are the United Christian Church of Dubai. We want to express our love and gratitude for all you've done for the body of Christ. May the Lord bless you all. I want to tell you that TBN is doing awesome and very powerful things. We here in Dubai are watching you all, and we are steady in our supplications for you all." Then, Madam Program Director, here are a couple of programming suggestions for you. Oh, my goodness. They want more Hal Lindsey, and they want more, I think, more T.D. Jakes. Yeah, and more Benny Hinn. Anyway, listen, from Saudi Arabia. Are you ready for this? Praise the Lord. Indeed, the TBN ministry is God's instrument in reaching the gospel to the whole world, even to the deserts of the Middle East. We always include your ministry in our prayers, that you would abound in spiritual and material blessings as you reach out to every lost soul in this world. It's almost 3 months now that our underground faith house, you know, you can get in trouble for being a Christian over in parts of the Middle East. Underground Faith House has installed our own satellite dish for the purpose of being connected to TBN. Wow. And truly, many of our brothers in the faith have been blessed by your programming. Many have expressed gladness and joy that the entry of Christian cable in Saudi Arabia, the public preaching of the gospel of Jesus Christ, will be fulfilled soon.
Wow.
Hallelujah. I'm about to get happy here. How about this, Pastor? From Corinth, Greece. That's one of the ancient churches. Apostolic Church of Christ, Corinth Church. "Dear Brother Paul, we greet you in the wonderful name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We want to tell you with this letter that here in Corinth we have been very blessed as we listen to your Christian messages from the Word of God through Channel TBN Europe. We have perfect reception here in Corinth, Greece. We pray that the Lord will give you strength to continue this wonderful work of the Lord." I'll just pause right here. Let's just praise the Lord. You know, a few years ago we had a full station on in Athens and two more other stations, and through sinister forces, they were taken away from us. And I worked harder on Greece than nearly any other country in the world. But guess what? God's sending it in by satellite now, and we're on anyway. Ha-ha, devil. Please know that the Church of Corinth is with you. We love you and want you to have spiritual communication with you through correspondence or whenever you come in Corinth. Please contact us. With Christian love, Pastor, I'll just say Pastor John. And oh, there's so many, many things. Oh, that's not enough. I got to tell you this one or two more here. This, I won't read it all, but, you know, they say, yeah, that prosperity message works in the United States, but it don't work out in the third world countries and the poorer nations. Listen, from Jamaica, West Indies. My name is Melrose Reddy. I pledged $4 U.S. for my one-year-old son, Daniel Stewart, and within 1 week, Daniel received 10,000 Jamaican dollars from a friend of his father. In my next letter to TBN, I'll be sure to send the tithe on this that Daniel has received. Hallelujah. Kampala, Uganda, dear TBN, that's where old crazy Idi Amin was for many years and just destroyed that nation. But now guess what? In Kampala, the capital, here is my seed of U.S. dollars five. Please pray for my business to grow and prosper. I also need energy and wisdom. I came to Christ watching TBN on TBN. Yours from Kampala, Uganda. And then just one or two quickies, very short ones. Do y'all know where Azerbaijan is? It's one of those former USSR republics, part of Russia before the fall of communism. Azerbaijan, go look it up on your little map. It's a largely Muslim nation. Dear TBN, I am Julian Pereira from the city of Baku, in Azerbaijan. I was watching the TBN program and the thought came to my mind, how could I get the people of Azerbaijan linked with the TBN network? I am a pastor from India. I worked in the United Arab Emirates and now working in Azerbaijan. I look forward to the advice from TBN now to expose this country to the gospel media. Get everybody down to the satellite shop and get one of those little dishes. That's real simple. I'll take care of that. And we'll let them know. Oh, just on and on, dear friends, from the Philippine Islands, from Dubai, from Trinidad, from Uganda again, and just all over the country. Nigeria, Pastor Jakes, listen to this. And then from all over the United States as well. But God bless you. Because of you, all of the missions projects are fulfilled. The 21 satellites are still up there. $1 million a month, dear friends. And some of you still need to phone in and make that call and make that pledge. How many of my little audience here tonight, you'd like a little pledge slip? I'll come up and I'll work on you tonight. Yeah. Some of you failed to call in on the telethon, so I'm coming to get you right now in Jesus' name. And we're going to keep those 2,716 television stations on the air worldwide in Jesus' name. And 21 satellites. Oh, praise God. Pastor Jakes and I just made a deal. He's going to keep preaching, and I'm going to keep building TV stations till Jesus comes. Amen? How many will help us? Come on, let's give Jesus a mighty praise.
You know what? I just have been listening to CNN a little bit today in the news of what's happening, and I just think tonight would be a wonderful night. Would you like to pray for our soldiers and our president? They're in harm's way, and we need to let them know. You know what? A lot of them are listening to us over there in that area. They have their little computer screens, and they can get us live, so they know that we're praying for them, and I would love to just pray for them tonight, Bishop. Go ahead.
As we pray, understand that ground troops are being dispatched even as we speak. Perhaps one of the most dangerous parts of the mission is taking place right now. They are in a harm's way. But he that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. Let's pray. Father, right now, in the name of Jesus, we ask you for your angels to encamp round about our sons and daughters, our young men and young ladies who are out on the battlefield tonight. Lord, as they enter into ground and into strange lands and into uncertainty and into active combat, I ask you to fight before us and to protect them. I pray for your divine divine anointing and grace to move in a supernatural way. We speak peace to their families. Somebody's wife is walking the floor tonight. Somebody's little boy, somebody's little girl is all upset. Some grandma is just wringing her hands praying tonight. Let a special peace and a special anointing be upon them right now and bring them back safely with a praise report giving you the glory. I thank you for deliverance in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 God bless you. Come on, give God a praise. Once again, for Paul and Jan, give God a praise. Are you ready for some music? Are you ready for some music? We're getting ready to have a wonderful time as we prepare to receive Beverly Crawford as she ministers to us in song. Put your hands together and give God a praise as she comes.
Offer of our salvation. Jesus. Oh, I adore you, Jesus. Oh, I bless your name, Jesus. Oh, you're wonderful, God. You're mighty, God. Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace, wonderful Counselor. Oh, my God. I love you, Jesus. How many are going to put all your troubles, all your worries in the hands of the Lord?
Lord, I don't know that I can. Lord, it's in your hands.
Lord, I am placing
it all into your hands. I didn't get much sleep last night. Tossed and turned in the morning light. I've been praying for my child. The last thing the world needs is another child running wild. I pour my heart out to you so that you know that I know you're a God who can. You're Jehovah Shalom, the God of peace, and I need peace. So I'm placing it all into your hands. Whoa. It's in your hands.
Lord, I've done all that I can.
I've done all that I can.
It's in your hands.
Lord, it's in your hands.
Lord, I am
placing, placing it all into your hands. I didn't get much sleep last night. I've been pacing the floor, Jesus, talking to you. And from the looks of things at the hospital, the doctors need to talk to you too. I pour my heart out to you so that you know that I know you're a God who can. You're Jehovah Rapha, the God who heals. So heal right now. I'm placing it all in your head. And your word says, cast your cares on me.
I
gave my only son for you. And after you've done all you can, you just stand still. Woo! Weeping may endure. The battle is not yours. So after you've done all you can, trouble comes on every hand. Your word says for me to stand. I pour my heart out to you. I worship you, Holy Lamb. Solid rock, God said, I'm placing it all in your hands. I'm placing it all in your hands. Yes, I am. Yes, I am. Yes, I am. Troubles, all of my sorrows, all of my worries, all my frustrations, everything, everything, I'm placing it in your hands.
Lord, I am placing,
placing it all
into
your hands.
It's in your hands.
They that wait on the Lord, they shall renew their strength. They're going to mount up with wings as an eagle. They're going to walk and not get weary, run and not faint. It's in your hands.
That's the answer. That's the solution. That's how you deal with issues that you can't handle. When your heart is overwhelmed, you just put it in the hands of God. He's able to fix it. Let's give God another praise for Sister Shirley Murdoch. Amen. The incomparable Shirley Murdoch. Why don't you take a moment and put her name and address on the screen so that you can avail yourself of her ministry and her expertise. She and Dale travel all over the country ministering the gospel in song in such a fresh and exciting way, placing things in God's hands. Ultimately, that's what you have to do. Evangelist Shirley Murdoch, she's exactly right. Turn it over to God. Stop worrying about it. Allow the Holy Spirit to touch you and strengthen you as only He can do. Once more, put your hands together and thank God for her. Beverly Crawford, too. They're both coming back. Hallelujah. They're both coming back for more, and you're going to be blessed and you're going to be delivered. We want to take a few moments now and begin to talk. I've got a couple of gentlemen here that I believe are going to be a significant blessing in your life. I'm glad to have them here today, and they're going to tell you a little bit more about their giftings and about their ministries. I want you to help me welcome Mr. Nathaniel Tate, elder, a minister, and a fine brother in the Lord. Nat, we're glad to have you here in the service of the Lord. It's good to be with you. Excited to have you here and excited about what God is doing in your life and in your ministry. And before we just turn you loose and let you just roll, I also want them to meet Curtis Wallace, a fine brother here that's here ministering and sharing and going to be talking to us a little bit. We're glad to have you here in the service of the Lord. And both of these brothers have similar giftings, but in different areas, dealing what I would call, what the Bible calls the gift of administration, which is very, very significant in the church today. You can have the gift of preaching, the pastoral gifts, the evangelistic gifts, but it's very, very important that you surround yourselves with competent people who understand administration, understand what the church, what God is saying to the church for such a time as this. And Nat, I'm going to let you just jump in first and share with us, bring us up today. I know what you're doing now,
yes.
But tell us a little bit about who Nat Tate is, where you've been, where you've come from.
Well, I come from a background of preachers. my mother, father, uncles, everybody was a preacher. And the Lord called me, went to Bible school. After Bible school, opened up my own recording studio. And then eventually, I was asked to start a TV station. Got a call and said, have you ever designed one? And I said, no, but I'd love to learn. And so I was invited to build a TV station, which I did in upstate New York, mm-hmm. after which I then went on to work for CBN. I mm-hmm. became the director of engineering and satellite communications for CBN. Did a lot of their work overseas and in Brussels and the Middle East and France. And it was a wonderful experience. And then after that, I opened up my own engineering firm. After the engineering firm, I decided, well, you know, it's time to do something else. So I became an engineer for the 1996 Olympics. I was at the Olympic Stadium, worked there, and we did feeds to 4 billion people. It was an exciting time. And then after that, I said, Lord, what do I do next? And I was sitting in New York City at my sister's house, and I saw a gentleman, a brother, preaching on the TV screen. And his name was Bishop T.D. Jakes. And my sister said, you know, you ought to write him and see if he has some engineering needs. And I'll never forget the day we met in West Virginia.
Yes.
And we stood in your office and prayed. And you yes. said, Nat, I don't know at this time if we'll ever meet again, but let's pray to see what God has in store for us.
Yes.
And about a year later, I got a call that there was an opening for an administrator at the Potter's House, and 1997, I came and joined the team, and I haven't regretted a day.
Amen. Amen. We haven't either. We haven't either. You know, that's a real roller coaster, right? I mean, you've done some of everything, been here and there. You know, when you were talking, I thought about the scripture that said, the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, mm-hmm. and how God delights in his way. And I think that God had the purpose, all of the giftings and all of the experiences that you had are now coming to bless our church and bless our ministry, bless CBN, bless people across the country, had your own business, and now taking a step to be able to bless beyond our church and to really catapult into ministering to other people. That doesn't necessarily mean he's leaving.
We're
not
giving
him
away.
But in a sense, we are making that gifting available to other people. What do you see as a need for churches today as they face the challenges of 21st century ministry?
Something I didn't input is that I do have a graduate degree in business. Mm-hmm. And that graduate degree has opened some real doors to help churches. The problem that I have seen with pastors is that they are the shepherd. They mm-hmm. are there to minister to the flock and
you're
to lead
them. You're not talking
about me, are you? Oh, no, I'm not talking about you. They're the shepherd to lead.
Yes.
but they need people around them that have the business expertise. The pastor should not have to go home and worry about all the things business-wise that happen in the church.
That is so true. That is so true. And speaking on behalf of pastors, you know, we most of us start out just on a very grassroots level. We've got a hands-on type of ministry, and many of us get stuck with that style of leadership and find it very difficult to move to the next level. We keep trying to preach harder and harder and harder to develop the church, not really understanding that if you don't put that foundation up under you, you can preach them in the front door and lose them out the back door because you haven't put in place the network and the infrastructure to be able to hold what's being brought into view. Uh-huh. I'm going to get back to you in just a moment, but I want Curtis to tell us a little about who Curtis Wallace is and what he's done and what he's doing.
What he's doing, you know, I am having a wonderful time at what I call the intersection of faith and business, where you put those two worlds together, and I really feel like my life to this point has been a preparation for that and getting me to that point. I have an undergraduate degree in business administration. Then I went on to Southern Methodist University to law school. Did very well in law school. Was highly recruited by all the big firms in Dallas and New York and all over the country, and could basically have any legal job that I wanted. Went to work for a large New York, very prestigious law firm. Got great experience there. Worked very hard, but was unfulfilled. Mm-hmm. And while I was in law school, I had worked some with Dennis Brewer, who's a local Christian lawyer here in town. Went back to Dennis, went to work for his firm, worked there for 5 or 6 years representing ministries all over the country. In 1996, a preacher from West Virginia came down to look at a church we were selling.
I stole him.
And I was the lawyer on the other side of the deal who sold Bishop Jakes the first church he had here in Dallas, and was having a wonderful time working at a great law firm representing ministries all over the country, helping them with their real estate projects, their construction projects, financings, whatever they needed, just general corporate work for churches all over the country, was having a great time, had just been made a partner in my firm, and Bishop Jakes calls me up and said, you know, what do you think about coming and doing some business with me? And it was, you know, the best thing I ever did. I remember standing in your office. I came over on a Monday for a meeting, and we made a decision right there in your office. It was just a God thing. I didn't even go back and talk to my wife. I called her on the way home and said, guess what we're doing? I hope you like it. And
hi, Jelena.
And since then, you know, we've had a wonderful time working, and I really view my job as being there to empower you. I need to allow you to be the pastor and to be creative and do what you're led to do. And my job and Nat's job is to go out there and execute those things. And at the same time, provide you, you know, with the protection that you need. And that's what my book is all about, is providing not only the shield that you need, the safety net that you need in this world that we live in, but also providing you with the sword that you need to go out there and establish your purposes and achieve your dreams, the things that have been breathed into you by the Lord. That's what I'm trying to do.
Well, you know, something comes to mind listening to both of you talk. There may be some people out there who are working in secular systems and working for law firms or whatever, and are frustrated, just frustrated, day-to-day, mundane routine, not really recognizing that there's a call of God on their life.
That's right.
A lot of people think that the only time God calls you is when he calls you to go preach.
That's right.
But this is as much a calling as anything else, don't you think?
Oh, it is. I'm not called to preach. I'm not called to be in front of the cameras. My job is to be behind the scenes and to empower ministries to do what they do. And, you know, there is a real need in the Christian world for these great people that are doing great things in the business world to come on over to this side. There's business to be done here.
Yes.
And Christian business is exploding. The music business, films, all the wonderful films that Matt Crouch is doing. Mm-hmm. And there is just exploding business to be done, and we need good people to come do that business.
We need good people, and we need good Christian people with sharp minds to protect what the Lord has invested in us.
You know? I think a good scenario, a church on the East Coast hired an individual. Mm-hmm. He was a custodian. Mm-hmm. And he did something that to a little girl that was malicious and mm-hmm. sexual harassing. Mm-hmm. The parents took that church to court. Mm-hmm. and sued them, took the church, the school buses, the schoolhouse, the church house, everything. Mm. It is now closed. Mm. Another situation where a church purchased land and did not do all their due diligence in investigating what the land was about, took all their money that they raised, found out that it had all sorts of toxic waste on it. They can't use it. Mm-hmm. Now, if that pastor had someone that they could refer to, mm-hmm. work with, or an administrator on staff, that is the key to keeping churches or pastors out of harm's way. And in my book, I deal with all of those issues in interviewing, how to interview an individual, how to do risk management, how to deal with issues and crises when they come into the church. There are approaches. I don't want the pastor, you are my pastor, I don't want to have the pastor to worry about a situation that comes in the church because there's no one qualified there to get behind you and support you. So it's so important that pastors today, more than ever,
yes.
have strong individuals with knowledge behind them to help them in those tough times.
You know, it's really critical. It's critical. You know, I shudder at the things that I've done wrong along the way, not knowing what to do, not trying to be wrong, just didn't know what to do. You believe God, you pray, and you start doing things, and somebody brings you a problem, and you mm-hmm. make the best decision
you can.
You get ready to go to the bank, and you're honestly, open-heartedly trying to do business, mm-hmm. and you have no clue what you're doing, and you just get down on your knees, Father, bless me as I go, and that's good.
Yes.
But there are some practical, pragmatic laws and rules that need to be put in place that can be implemented, whether you're a small church, which I think is important because I started a church with an empty room full of people, mm-hmm. an empty room, no people, fantasizing about people, hoping somebody would come from somewhere, and you know, just doing it on a very small level. I couldn't afford an attorney, mm-hmm. you know, I couldn't afford a staff, I couldn't afford right. a whole lot of people, mm-hmm. and if I would have been able to get the resources that I needed in my hand to help me avoid pitfalls. There are so many churches out there that are not handling their taxes properly.
Yes.
Pastors not handling their taxes properly, don't know how to handle offerings, don't know when to invite or engage someone, tied up in real estate battles, tied up in all kinds of issues that are even in counseling today.
That's right.
Even in counseling, pastors have to be so careful how they counsel and counsel and what they say because the laws are changing every day.
I was told by an attorney, as a matter of fact, that if a pastor counsels from the Word of God, mm-hmm. if he is teaching from God's law and His Scripture, then he is in a better situation when it comes to counseling than trying to be a pseudo-psychologist or psychiatrist. Mm-hmm. He's not trained to do that, mm-hmm. but he is trained to teach out of the Word of God. And if he stays with the Word, he's safe.
Yeah, and he needs to know that. We need to know, as pastors for the 21st century, where the lines are. When am I crossing the line? Who to do business with? One of the things that I loved about your book, you made a statement about watching out for people when you do business.
That's right.
Who come quoting scriptures and
That's
acting
right.
real spiritual. Sure. And it sounds strange because that would make you feel really comfortable.
Bull.
You
That's
know,
right.
you say, oh, this is really a Christian. But when it comes down to doing business, if the person doesn't deal with the facts, you explain it.
Well, one of the things that I've encountered over and over again as I've represented different ministries and done work for you is when people come into churches and they want to do business with churches, a lot of times the people who are not real come in and clothe themselves in the cloth of Christianity.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And they want you to think that because I'm this good person, because I'm a Christian, I'm going to be wonderful at doing this business for you. But what I've always learned is that serious business people get down to business.
Right.
And if at some point in time that person is not getting down to business, they're not getting into what the facts are, what your issue is, what the problem is, what they're going to do for you, how much it's going to cost, there's probably a problem there. And when the people, all they want to do is be spiritual, that's wonderful. We all need to get together and we go to church, we can have dinner afterwards and do all of that. And that's a wonderful thing. And we want to do business with Christian people. But at the same time, you need to sit back and say, you know, we've never gotten down to the business. And serious business people will get down to the business. And when they do that, then you're going to find out if you're with the real deal or not. If you've got somebody who wants to build a church for you, but he doesn't want to talk about what he's built, there's a problem there. And you need to be careful about that.
And another thing is that a lot of times, and we're walking on sensitive ground here, a lot of times someone in the church will say, you know, Pastor, I'll put the air conditioning in and mm-hmm. do it at a real discount price for you.
Right.
It sounds good. But I was in a seminar where a pastor stood up and said, I had that done. And the air conditioning didn't work.
Right.
And so he had to go back to the brother.
That's the problem.
So what do you
That's
do right. now? I mean, do you sue the brother in your church, or, right. or what do you do? Right. So it's better to keep business and church separate when you're doing a deal, as right. they say in the secular field.
Right. In business, be men. The Bible's gotcha. Very clear about it. In business, be men. And I think many, many times we innocently get into trouble. When we were first engaged in building the church, and we built a $41 million facility
right.
There in Dallas, there's so many pitfalls. So many dangerous places that we had to maneuver past laws and state laws and some political issues and most pastors, when they start building, soon run into some kind of legal battle. Frustration. They have nightmares after nightmares, and I really don't have any nightmares to tell. Maybe you do.
I do.
maybe you do, but I didn't.
In the our last pastors conference, we had about 7,000 pastors there, and we had a seminar. And I said, "How many of you know your city council members?" And out of, I think, 1,000 people there in that seminar, maybe 20 people raised their hands. It's so important that somebody in the church, not the pastor necessarily, but an administrator or a representative of the church, get to know the city council members. Get
right.
to know who are the players in the city.
Right,
And
right.
if you don't do that, when you want something, you don't know who to go to.
Well, you know, the pastors are trying to do it all. They're trying to preach. They're trying to visit the sick. They're trying to marry and bury and do all. It's just too much.
Yes,
it's like Moses.
Yes,
Moses said,
That's
this
right.
is too much. And there may be some pastors watching us right now. You're overwhelmed. You're frustrated. You're at the end of your rope because you're trying to be everything to everybody. It's stressful. And God spoke clearly through Jethro to Moses to tell him, look, this is too much. You're going to have to find somebody, put your spirit upon them, and release them that they can undergird so that you're not tied up in trying to judge every issue.
Uh-huh.
And it is very, and I thank God for the discernment of spirits and being able to discern spiritually right. many, many things, but it is also an advantage to have somebody who can read through a contract.
That's right.
You know, while you got your eyes squinting, you're speaking in tongues. It sure is nice to have somebody who can read for the whereas, for the which cause, and to wit,
right.
and all of that,
you're
to make
right.
sure that you are signing what you mean to be signing, buying what you mean to be buying, hiring who you mean to hire. Mm-hmm. And when you do have to dismiss somebody, how do you go about doing that? Many of us volunteer. We've got people in children's church that we don't examine, and they're handling our children. It used to be that wasn't the problem. Today, you have to be careful who's teaching Vacation Bible School.
That's right.
It's critical.
Anyone who teaches children, and I think it in our particular church is 12 and below,
mm-hmm.
you have to have a background check.
Mm-hmm.
And it's very important because there may be someone who has had something in their past that God has forgiven,
mm-hmm.
but we don't want to put them in harm's way.
Right.
And so it's very wise that background checks are done on anyone
mm-hmm.
that deals with children.
And you know, a lot of these things can be done very simply and very easily yes. without a whole lot of expense, and a lot of people don't know that.
Mm-hmm.
Setting up 501c3, setting up EDCs and
That's
CDCs,
right.
when to do them, how to do that. And a lot of people are spending, I'm appalled at how much money they're spending to do something that they could easily do at a minimal amount of expense.
Well, that's exactly right. You know, one of the things we really tried to do, I tried to do in my book, is we wanted to make things simple for people. There's some basic things, and if you just know the basic things, you're going to get 10 steps down the road, and you really don't need to spend crazy money sometimes.
So, you know, a lot of the churches are, you know, there's a lot of seminars going around today with people who are supposedly experts and selling, you know, boxes and that kind of thing. And a lot of the information that they can get it on their own, mm-hmm. or they can get textbooks like what we've written
mm-hmm.
that will help them a lot better than buying stuff that they can't use and it's impractical.
And you know what's really, really good about being able to get it in a book, even if you're not a professional, if you don't have time to go back to school, you can kind of bone up well enough to kind of sift through
that's
boardroom.
Right.
And I'm grateful to be able to kind of make my way through a boardroom without stepping on some toes or feet along the way.
Mm-hmm.
So you don't have to be intimidated as a pastor or as a church leader, because I think this is bigger than pastors. Church leaders, church administrators, pastors, wives, people people in the leadership of their church need to be abreast of what is out there and what's available
that's
to
right.
them. And bone up on it, even if you do ultimately consult with professionals,
mm-hmm.
you'll
right.
be able to talk the talk. You understand the lingo. They don't lose you in the conversation. And then you can go back and pray and make appropriate decisions.
Mm-hmm.
Where is God taking our church now? And how to safely steer that church through the storm? I see the church as a ship. I see the world as the sea, and I see the enemy as the storm. And if we're going to float the church through the world in the midst of the storm of the enemy, there's got to be somebody there to help navigate that
That's
thing.
Right. That's right.
And this is very, very important. Mm-hmm. One of the things we've been doing that I think is important to mention is amidst all of the duties that I've had you guys tied up in doing, God's really laid on my heart to make available the giftings that we have used at the Potter's House available to you and to your church and to your city. And no, these guys can't go everywhere. But from time to time, they are able to go into select cities and do seminars and do workshops. And every now and then, I'm able to go with them. But even when I can't go, they're able to go and sit down with your leadership,
That's
your
right.
staff, or particularly regionally,
That's
if
right.
we could bring the regions
That's
together
right. mm-hmm.
and work with them to help secure wolf-proof. This,
mm-hmm.
to me,
That's
is
right.
wolf-proofing mm-hmm. your church so that the enemy doesn't take down sincere, good people
yes.
because they
trying
don't know
to
what
good
to do.
Things
That's right.
That make simple mistakes.
That's right. And I think that we can give the basic skills to them in a way that's meaningful to them.
Mm-hmm.
And in the places that we can't go physically, we can get the books. They can get the books. They
yes,
can get
they
the
can.
Material. This particular book says in the multitude of counsel, and Curtis, tell them a little bit about how you put this together.
What I did when I started to put this book together, I wanted to put something together that would empower pastors and empower church leaders. And there really is wisdom and safety in a multitude of counsel. And there is no one lawyer who knows it all and no one lawyer who can do everything. And so what I did was I assembled the all-star team. I got David Middlebrook at Brewer Brewer, Anthony in Middlebrook, Tom Winters at Winters King and Associates in Tulsa, and Tom Gearing, who's an entertainment lawyer in LA, and we got together and we each contributed what we really know about. And we wrote about different areas of our own particular expertise.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the things that I did in the book that I think people will really enjoy is I wrote a chapter on how to hire and manage lawyers.
Yes.
Because I am a lawyer, but now I'm in a position of actually hiring and managing outside
so
lawyers.
So you can tell on them
So
a
I can tell on them a little
them,
bit.
Brother. Tell
yeah,
on
I
them.
Told some of our secrets in there. And I hope Tom Winters isn't watching and Dennis isn't watching, but you know, I told some of their secrets in there about, you know, how lawyers work and the different ways that we structure ourselves and how we charge for our services and what you need to look for in a bill.
You know, it's amazing because I think, what does this book sell for?
$50.
A $50 book could save you hundreds of thousands of dollars of information just in finding out some of the table of contents, how to form and maintain a nonprofit corporation, getting and maintaining tax-exempt status, how to get it, how to maintain it, how not to lose it by making right. foolish mistakes needlessly, maximizing your real estate as you're purchasing, not only for the church, but for you as a pastor when you purchase a home, when it
That's
needs
right.
to be a parsonage, when it doesn't need to be a parsonage, those sorts of things. Minimizing your risk of liability, how to make sure that you bring it to a minimum, how to effectively hire and manage lawyers is something I think is a powerful chapter right. because a lot of people, once they hire the lawyer, they don't manage them.
No, they let them go. They let them do
yeah.
whatever they're going to do. And
yeah.
they expect the lawyers to make decisions for them. And one of the things I always loved about doing work for you before I came to work with you was I was a counselor to you. I wasn't making your decisions.
Right.
And one mistake that I see pastors making is they would hire me or somebody else as a lawyer and they would expect me to make their business decisions for them.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not the lawyer's job.
No.
The lawyer's job is to provide information and options and to put those in front of you and explain those to you so you can do what you need to do.
Well, one of great, this one here, taking your ministry to the world via Hollywood. The Bible, I believe now it's never before, God is sending us into all the world to preach the gospel
yes, he is.
And to share, but we need to understand the laws in the world and how to respond to those issues. And then finally, it deals with the pastor's business. Now, what is that about, the pastor's business?
What that is about, in the world that we're in today, with all these opportunities available in Hollywood and entertainment and music and books and everything else like that, I talk about when a pastor should set up his own business, like we've done for you. And he sometimes needs to have his own company, his own business. He needs to be building his own wealth independently.
This is not the church now. This is separate from the church.
This is separate from the church. Right. You know, a pastor should take care of himself. Mm-hmm. And setting up a business, if he's going to do books or if he's going to write music or if he's going to write a stage play or do a movie or whatever it is, those businesses oftentimes need to be outside of the church. They need to be separate and part of his personal business. And I tell you, how to set those up.
Mm-hmm. Okay, one of the things I can hear somebody saying, well, there's no reference in the Bible for that, but it really is. Paul was a tent maker, because he was able to make tents, he wasn't the hardship that he would have been on the church.
That's right.
Because he had extracurricular ways of drawing income. I've been teaching our church that there were four rivers that led into Eden. You need more than one financial stream to be able to flow where there's a great vision. That the pastor can give, he can do. If he chooses to do that, he has the flexibility to do that. We're running out of time, but I want to talk just a little bit more about this church strategies for the 21st century. What's unique about the 21st century and the strategies we need today?
Well, how I gathered the information and materials for that book was that over the last 2.5-3 years, I was interviewing pastors, talking to pastors. They were asking questions, numerous questions, and a lot of them, they were the same questions of needs that they had. So we took those questions and broke them down into information that would help them in their church, from writing policies to dealing with interviewing for television, dealing with grant writing, all of it. It's all in there. It's the Swiss Army knife for pastors. It's got everything in it.
It's heavy. It's big. How much does this book cost?
That's $100.
It's a $100 book. It's loaded with information. It's an almanac. It's a CD in here?
Yeah, there's a CD in there, and it has forms on it that they can use in their office, right. Application forms, evaluation forms, all the kinds of things that would help them in managing their church.
Can you share with them how they can get the books and how they can get in touch with you all for seminars and workshops? And we want to stress that these seminars would be regional and not just individual churches, because I can't loan them out quite that long.
That's right. That's right. Well, they would contact, we have an internet site. It's echurchstrategies.com. Mm-hmm. And they can order the book on the internet site.
That's right.
Or they can call Curtis's office if they would like to get information about seminars. And Curtis, you can give them that.
That's right. And that's at 214-337-4100. And we can get you information on seminars. Also, I'll repeat the website, echurchstrategies.com, has information about the books. We're going to be putting new information on that website all the time, mm-hmm. Sharing new things every month.
New articles every month.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's a great thing. I want to take just a moment. You know, there's nothing like getting into trouble trying to do church work, and you're really trying to do all that God would have you to do. You find yourself a bit overwhelmed. You're stressed out. You've got conflicts going on in your church. You've got conflicts going on about property. You've got conflicts going on between memberships. You've got takeovers and splits going on in your church. I know what that's like, to be overwhelmed. At the end of your rope, you're trying to do things innocently. You're attacked on every side. You're being criticized. You're dealing with the media. You're dealing with obstacles. You're dealing with misunderstandings, offenses, and all of that. We want to believe God with you. Maybe you can't get the book. Maybe you can't go to the conference. But we want to pray with you that the very best that God has for you would flow into your life. Do not be discouraged and don't be overwhelmed. I'm praying for you that God would touch you. Let's just take a moment and touch and agree that the Spirit of God would just flow into every need and every situation. Brother Nat, would you just lead us in prayer?
Oh, Father, we just pray right now for the pastors throughout this nation that carry the burden of leadership. Many of them are pushing instead of leading. And we ask you, Lord God, to give them the wisdom and the direction that they so sorely need. Lord, we know that you have given them to lead their flocks, and we ask you by the power of the Holy Ghost that you would bring someone into their ministry, into their life, that will help them and to assist them. And Lord, we're just resting in you, knowing that you have everything in control. When that pastor lays in bed at night, wondering what's going to happen next, Lord, give him peace. Let him know that you have it under control. And Father, as we look to thee for continued strength and direction as pastors, we ask you to supply the needs financially, whatever it might be.
Yes, Lord.
We see the wife, Father, that sits at home sometimes wondering what to do. We ask that you would bless the wife of the pastor as well. And God, we just thank you and we praise you. And we thank you, God, that we are able to stand in the gap to help pastors around the country. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you for coming. Thank God for Jesus. Thank God for what he's doing. You be encouraged. Once again, put those addresses on the screen so they can see how to get in touch with them. And you write us and let us know if we can be a blessing or encourage you to keep on keeping on. I want to see your church thrive and grow and be all that God would have it to be. Now, Sister Beverly Crawford, that powerhouse, that anointed dynamo, is singing for us, "I Won't Go On."
My life alone, not on my own, without you by my side. I don't have the power to stand. Please give me your hand to comfort and to guide along the way. Every day I cannot go on unless I know you're there. Ooh. There is nothing I want to do, not without you helping me alone. I cannot survive all by myself. Lord, I need your help, so I won't go wrong alone. Every day I cannot go on unless I know you're there. I won't go on, I won't go on, I won't go on unless I know you're there. I won't go on, I just can't go on, I won't go on unless I know you're there. I know just how it feels to live outside your will and the glory. I can't even breathe on my own.
Glory, 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 glory. I don't know whether you can feel it out there, but I declare we can feel it in here. The Spirit of God is in this place. Come on, give God a praise. Woo! Hallelujah. Glory. I won't go on unless I know that you are there and the Lord is there to bless you and strengthen you and keep you. God has more in store for you than what you've seen. Let's thank God again for Beverly Crawford. Put her name and address up on the screen. They've got her new release up there. You need to run out and get it right now with your house shoes on. Get in the car and go out there and get that new release and put it in your car and drive carefully. Amen, because Beverly will make you wreck a car. She's a blessed woman of God, and we're glad to have her here. Let me tell you something. The gentleman sitting beside me is a gift to the body of Christ. He's a gift to the body of Christ. They got him out in L.A., but every now and then we steal him out here in Dallas. He travels all over the world, been to Jamaica, been to Africa, New York, Canada, all over the world, ministering, preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. We're honored to have him here tonight. I'm talking about none other than Bishop Noel Jones. Welcome to TBN. Bless you, sir. Somehow. Bishop Jones, there are all kinds of people watching from literally all over the world, but I'm focusing in on Los Angeles. Tell them a little bit about what's going on in L.A. and how God is using you there in Los Angeles.
Well, the Lord has been extremely good to me. L.A. It seems to be the place where God wanted me to be. God has blessed us tremendously. We've grown 100 a month for so long, I can't even.
My God, 100 a month.
100 a month.
Some people don't say 100 a year.
Well, 100 a month, and it's a lot of work, of course, because I'm doing 4 services on Sunday. Yes. I was doing fine with 4 services on Sunday. I didn't give it much thought until somebody said to me, you know, you're doing a revival, a week's revival in one day. And all of a sudden, I got real tired.
Yeah, I
was doing fine. But yes, it's necessary because people are hungry for the Word of God, particularly with the time in which we live and the things that are happening. And I think that if the ministry is psychological in its impact, then people will come to hear. I think if it's more philosophical, less psychological, and people are arguing about points mm-hmm. instead of meeting needs, mm-hmm. then I think that those days are gone.
Well, your church just moved or you just bought. Tell them how to get to your church.
Well, we're about to move from where we are now, and we're going to Gardena. It's going to be by the first of the year.
First of all, where are you now?
Right now, I am at Hoover in Manchester in L.A. It's South Central. It's 8415 Hoover Street, but the cross street is Hoover in Manchester. And it's easy to get there from any direction in town.
I don't understand. One of the things that always blows my mind about your church, you've got everybody from the down and out to the up and out. There are movie stars, there are actors that come in there and shout and praise God and get set free. How in the world did God open up a door for you to be able to impact Hollywood like you do?
Well, I think one of the things is that, first of all, I grew up in a diverse family. And I think that has a lot to do with it, too. Being able to bridge between who people are and what they do.
Yeah.
Oftentimes, a church looks and frowns on people who have certain jobs or people in the music world, people who sing, people who do various things. And consequently, they never associated that with being Christian. Mm-hmm. The fact that I grew up in a family with Grace Jones and others who have that kind of diversity, so I can...
I spoke to Grace today.
Yeah, yeah.
She's indeed. Got your cell phone.
Yeah, right. And she's at my house, too, so... anyway,
hallelujah.
So it's wonderful.
Hi, Grace.
because of the diversity, you know, Chris Tucker is with me, and we've got Tavis Smiley, Brandy is there, Bill Bellamy. There's so many people who need the kind of word
yes.
because of the pressure.
Yes.
That they're under, and they need the kind of word. They don't need to be judged. Actually, they need to be blessed with the Word of God, to make good decisions, to do the right thing. Chris doesn't even curse anymore.
Mm-hmm.
He does no cursing. Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Jesus.
And that's a blessing.
What do you think, in a nutshell, that God has really placed on your heart a word that the body of Christ needs today. Where are we going and how are we going to get there, particularly after September 11th and what we faced, at least in this country? And I shouldn't say this country because it actually affected the whole world. What is God really saying to you?
Well, if I were going to talk, I may talk a little bit later about it, but I think that all of us must understand the price of being gifted. I think there's a price to pay to be gifted. I'm sure you know it as an individual.
I'll drink to that.
And collectively, all of us have to face the whole issue of being gifted, because being gifted means that there will be an attack. Mm. I think essentially that's where we are as a nation, mm-hmm. because of the gift that God has given us, mm-hmm. and the gift to the world, actually, in terms of gospel, in terms of technology, mm-hmm. in terms of industrialization, mm-hmm. in terms of so many things, that there has to be an attack. I have found that, and maybe I'll talk about it later, depends, you know, because you talked about so many wonderful things here tonight, but I have found that exposure, I would like to say that exposure causes you to be appreciated or hated. But what I've found is that exposure, it's no or. There's no or there.
It's and.
There is appreciation and there is hatred. Mm-hmm. There is not appreciated or. Right. I wish it were that.
Right.
Because you'd have one or the other.
Right.
But when you're appreciated on one side, you're despised on the other.
True.
And it's all together.
Isn't it amazing how you can have both of those things coexisting at the same
time? At the same time.
Yeah, it's absolutely amazing.
At the same time. And you should look at that as a confirmation of your gift.
You know, I think that's a very, very important point, because a lot of times when people are hated, they feel like they're doing something wrong.
Ah.
And what they really do need to understand, that often that being hated is a sign that you're actually doing something right.
It's a confirmation.
Yeah.
So you have to learn, I think that, I guess we both have learned, to look at the negative positively.
Yes.
Because that helps you to survive.
Yes.
And for instance, blind Bartimaeus is hollering. He's hollering, "Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me." And he can't see. I guess he just senses the crowd, feels an anointing, mm-hmm. knows that something unusual is happening, and he hollers, "Have mercy on me, have mercy on me." But still his faith is not yet confirmed. Mm-hmm. But now when somebody tells him to shut up, mm-hmm. now he knows that I'm close to something wonderful, and he hollered even the more. And that's critical. That's critical.
You can see why he's such a well-respected and honored preacher. If somebody's telling you to shut up, you need to holler
all even
the more. You're on the verge of a breakthrough, something wonderful right. about to happen in your life. I really sense an anointing on that word, and I'm anxious for what you're going to preach tonight, because it is so relevant to where we are today, and you need to seize this opportunity. Many, many people get depressed.
Yes, yes.
Because on one hand, they are gifted, and they reach out to receive the gift, but in the process of reaching to get the gift, like Paul gathering the wood, there's right. always a snake in the wood.
Snake in the wood.
You know, and they fool around. I want the heat, right, I want the right, fire, right, right. but I fool around and get bit. Mm. But you can't give up on your wood just because there's a snake in it. You still got to right. build your fire anyway. And it's important. I need you to pick up the phone. Call somebody who's discouraged.
Yes.
Call
yes.
somebody that you know that's gifted and they're going through a tough time right now. Their marriage may be up under attack. Their finances may be up under attack. Sometimes your children are up under attack. Sometimes it's not you the enemy comes against. Sometimes it comes after your son or after your daughter in a significant way. Comes after your health in a significant way. Regardless of which way it comes, it is because of the level of gifting that's on your life. There's going to be a word in just a moment that they need to hear. You need to be dialing while I'm talking so you can hear what God is going to say through Bishop Noel Jones. And I want to challenge you, if you're anywhere near L.A., if you're in Oakland, which is a little dry, but if you're anywhere within 3 or 4 hour proximity, you need to go down to Greater Bethany and experience the anointing that's on this man of God. He doesn't care whether you're black, whether you're white, whether you're brown, whether you're mixed, whether you're striped, whether you're polka dot, makes no difference to him. He will love you and care for you with the love of Jesus Christ. Give God a praise once again for the man of God. He's going to be preaching. He's going to be preaching a life-changing word. And just before we go to song, would you just tell them what you expect them to get out of the few minutes you're just going to briefly share a sermonette with them?
Well, I'm expecting all those who felt like they should give up and quit, to understand the positiveness in the negative, to understand that this confirms where you are. And I'm going to do my best to prove that by the Word of God.
Thanks,
that, that oftentimes the gift is not exposed and it's not attacked. Mm-hmm. But once the gift is exposed, it's attacked.
You got a shouting corner over here, brother.
And that is quite critical. And it doesn't matter who you are. But when your purpose is defined, and once you come into the realization of your purpose, then you have to look for the enemy to try to sweep you away from where God would have you to be.
I thought what you said was very powerful in relationship to this nation because of the level of gifting. I never thought of it that way. That was on this nation, that we would go through that kind of attack. It is so, so very, very true. And I think we as Americans often do not recognize the magnitude of the gift that we have.
And that is critical too, because see, many times what the devil does to many gifted people, and you look through the scriptures, you can see David and so many others, that oftentimes we become the tool by which he affects our gift. And that's another thing that we have to disallow. We have to disallow Satan to attack us from the outside, but we also have to disallow his attack from the inside. Mm-hmm. Because once I fail to understand how significant I am, then I will allow things in my life that I should never touch.
Thank you, Jesus. That's a powerful word all by itself. You need to hear this man of God minister the Word of God. He's got a message. He's got a word for you. He's in Los Angeles. He's the pastor of Greater Bethany. He's on television now.
Yes, I'm on BET.
Yeah, he's
every
on BET.
Every Wednesday morning, Fresh Oil.
Yeah, Fresh Oil on BET. Check the man out. Or get on his website, get your hands on his material, call Greater Bethany. There's a great word for you. He's going to give us just a sample tonight. We're just going to turn him loose for about 20 minutes. If I turn him loose, I'm going to tell you something, your whole television will blow up in 45 minutes. I'm giving you about 20 minutes of it.
20 minutes.
Right after Shirley Murdoch, a great woman of God. God's done so many wonderful things in her life. She's going to minister the dream.
Anybody got a dream in here tonight? Hallelujah. Let's just give God some praise and some glory. Because whatever he started in you, he's going to finish that good work. Amen?
Trouble often comes to destroy the dream within. It's hard to find a friend that wants to see you win. Trouble often comes to destroy what we believe, but the dream lives on inside of me, growing strong in spite of me. Through it all, my dream, it will survive. Whoa, God gave me a dream that would not die. God cannot lie. God showed me, he showed me the dream that would not die. The dream. That set him apart from men, a dream that gave him courage to overcome his every sin.
Joseph dreamed a dream.
One day he'd have honor,
and power.
He'd have power, and when they laughed at what he said, he found the strength to raise his head. The dream, it still survived. Oh, 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 God gave me a dream that would not die. God cannot lie. Oh, God, show me. He showed me the dream that would not.
Dream
cannot
die.
to the very end.
Hold on to the dream. Hold on to the dream.
Cause I know.
Hold on to the dream.
I would like to share with you in the book of 2 Timothy, chapter 1, just for a few minutes, the word of the Lord comes to us from about verse 6, where he says, "Wherefore I put thee in remembrance that thou stir up the gift of God which is in thee by the putting on of my hands. For God hath not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. Be not thou therefore ashamed of the testimony of our Lord, nor of his prisoner, but be thou partaker of the afflictions of the gospel according to the power of God, who hath saved us, called us with an holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, which was given us in Christ Jesus before the world began, but now is made manifest by the appearing of our Savior Jesus Christ, who hath abolished death, brought life, immortality to light through the gospel, whereunto I am appointed a preacher and apostle and a teacher of the Gentiles." Now notice, "For the which cause I also suffer these things. Nevertheless, I am not ashamed, for I know whom I have believed, and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I have committed unto him against that day." For a few minutes, I'd like to talk about your being guarded, just being guarded. It would seem that there are some things in this particular text that might be a little ambiguous. I wouldn't say contradictory, I probably could, but let's just say ambiguous. And the part that is most ambiguous in my thinking, if you look at it from the surface, is to be a partaker of the affliction of the gospel according to the power of God. Now notice now, to be a partaker of the affliction. Most of us who have come into the house of God, and most of us who are gifted and called by God, are definitely not looking to be afflicted. In fact, we came into the house of God to eliminate affliction. And so when you read here that I should be a partaker of the gospel, and even a partaker of the affliction of the gospel, it seems as if affliction and good news should not go together. You see, here is the little point that is so significant here. He speaks it in such a manner as if to indicate that God has to strengthen me to be a partaker of the affliction of the gospel when my whole approach to gospel is to move the affliction. So now I have to resolve what seems to be ambiguous to me. I have to resolve it, because how can I be a powerhouse in God and have to deal with the whole concept of affliction? Well, affliction comes because God has laid his hand on me. And it is so much a part of the gospel that you cannot avoid it. Why? Because once you're gifted, you are now open to the enemy to attack the gift of God that is in you. If I were to deal with this from another point of view, I would show you that when the gift is in the hand of God, before it is transferred to the individual, the gift cannot be attacked. There is no devil who can go into the throne room of God and attack the gift that he is about to distribute to his children. No devil can do that. But once the gift is transferred from the eternal resources of God to the individual, now Satan can attack the gift that is in you. It is critical to understand this now, because every time a gift is given, there is a challenge to that gift. If you notice, and let's just do a little deeper here, that when you deal with Christ, he could not be attacked unless he was in the flesh. James says that God cannot be tempted, neither does he tempt any man. Yet Jesus is God incarnate. It is the incarnation of Jesus Christ that opens him up to the attack of the enemy. For the enemy cannot attack Jesus in the recesses of heaven, but he can attack him once he realizes that he is the emissary of God to do the will of God in the earth. Anytime you pray, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven, you have just signed up to become used by God to defeat the enemy. And whenever the enemy understands that you have something in you that is going to hurt or harm his kingdom, he's coming after you with everything he's got. It's critical to understand this, because oftentimes we see the attack of the enemy as a weakness on our part. And oftentimes we back up because we feel like something has to be wrong. Why, every time I make a move, something comes after me. And we back up because we feel like maybe I'm off, or maybe I have not walked according to the will of God, so consequently, I am in serious trouble. But the fact of the matter is, once God has laid his hand on me and the devil has seen that I am now God's tool against him, he comes after me with everything he's got. He cannot destroy the gift, but he can destroy the carrier of the gift. So because God has implanted his power in me and I have now been exposed as a weapon of God, then Satan comes immediately against me. The critical thing here is for me to look at the negative positively. Before God laid his hand on me, Satan didn't want me. But now that God has laid his hand on me, everything is breaking against me. So instead of backing up and crying about it, I look at Satan's attack and simply say, you have just confirmed what I have already believed, and that is that God has his hand on me. It is here then that Paul deals with this, because he's pointing out then that the individual who has been entrusted with the gift of God is now open for the enemy to come after him. He makes this point to Timothy because he says, now I don't want you ever to be timid because of the attack of the devil. You've got to stir up the gift that is in you. You've got to keep working on the power of this gift, because God intends to use you to break strongholds down. There are those of you who are listening to me right now that God has laid his hand on you. And now that he's laid his hand on you, folk on the job don't like you. Folk in your neighborhoods don't like you. People around you don't like you. But for everybody that does not appreciate what God has done, there are 20 people who do. And you cannot allow the few to stop you from blessing the many. Oh, I feel like preaching now. It is here then that Paul realizes why he is suffering. He says, for this cause. For what cause? For the fact that God has called me out of obscurity into dominance. Now, this is the reason why the enemy is coming against me. Every time God uses you to bless somebody, the enemy comes against you. Every time God uses you to lift somebody from the level they are to a higher level, the enemy comes against you. But it's important to realize that no matter how he attacks you, the power of God is there to keep you in the midst of his attack. This is why he says, I want you to be a partaker of the affliction according to the power of God. He doesn't say out of. Because if he uses the word out of, I can give you something out of what I have and it still not be enough. But if he says according to, that means I'm going to power you according to or out of all the resources that God has. Not just a little, but everything. In other words, I need all of his power to anoint me to do the job. Then I need all of his power to keep me in affliction. So the same God who has anointed me to do the job is the same God who covers me or guards me with his power. He does not set me up to fail or set me up to allow the devil to overcome me. But what he does is he exposes how significant I am by how much the devil attacks. You'll have to look at how you're being attacked and decide how powerful God has made you. And this is why the writer declares, now I am not ashamed here. There's no need to be ashamed, because ashamed here now is a feeling that is expressed by this word that brings dishonor or shame to men. And what the writer is saying very subtly here is, you've got to be careful how you look at yourself because of what you go through. Oftentimes people will say, well, how can you be so powerful going through what you're going through? Well, understand this, as long as you're not ashamed of what you're going through, because you know your connection to God, then the problem will forever be external and never internal. The thing that you and I must do is keep the negative outside. You can't allow what people think to come in and break down the machinery of your relationship with God. Because when you're in touch with God and the power of God moving in you, there is no obstacle that he cannot bring you through. And if he gifted you and given you purpose, there is no devil in hell that can stop it. And so you've got to realize this, that he guards everybody that he gifts. He places in them the power of his strength, and then he guards them carefully. The word he uses here is that God marches around my mind. It is a military expression here, that when he uses the word keep, he marches around me. He keeps my mind in perfect peace in spite of the attacks of the enemy. And what he causes me to do is learn how to focus on his will, and focus on his purpose, and not spend time dealing with the petty negatives that are around me, but focus on the things of God, knowing that he will bring in my power everything that Satan has thrown at me. So I don't use it as a stumbling block. I rather use the devil's attitude as a stepping stone. For every time the devil would trip me up, I move to another level. And what God declares is, greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. And this is the guard that keeps me. And so Paul can declare, now I am persuaded. I've been through enough. I've been through the attacks. I've been where the devil wanted to destroy. I've been through the conspiracies. I've been through the snakes. And I am still holding on to the power of the living God. He guards with the strength that allows me to realize that no weapon formed against me shall prosper. It is this knowledge here that Paul talks about. Because in order to be persuaded, you have to have gnosko.
You have to have experience with God, and you have to have seen how he protects and keeps in spite of the things we go through. And everybody who has been used of God realizes this. The more I go through, the stronger I become. One man told the story of God telling him to push a wall. And he pushed and he pushed and he pushed, but the wall would never come down. The question now was, Lord, how can you have me pushing and the wall not come down? And the answer came to him one day, I didn't tell you the wall would come down, but look at your arms and look at your chest. You grew stronger because of the obstacle. Anybody who has been close to God understands this. We don't always grow when things are pleasant. We grow when things get rough. It's when the going is tough and life seems to be a great obstacle when God brings the strength in our spirit. And once the strength of God rises in our spirit, we can tell the devil, I have been with God. And you can't push me off the edge with any little thing, because God has strengthened me through persecution. It is here now that Paul realizes that his time is soon up. And he sends a word to Timothy, as I send to everybody who will listen, that no matter what you're going through, when God has anointed you, he will bring you out. He will bring you out because he brings things and allows them to happen to put us in a place to realize that the power is not our power, but it is the power of God. And this is how God works. He allows the circumstance that Satan throws at you to destroy you to simply become another situation for his revelation. He does not allow the circumstance to destroy you, but rather it forces you to get closer to him that you might go forward in faith. You must go forward in faith because you have to look beyond your situation and circumstance by the power of his spirit and see where he wants to take you. And where God wants to take you is through the enemy lines, because the enemy is not going to lie down and let you take over without a fight. But every time he moves against you, the Lord empowers you with greater depth, with higher heights, with greater knowledge. And as the knowledge begins to flow within you, you understand that I can carry the circumstance through the flood and the fire to give God the glory out of my life. Oh, it's one thing to praise him when things are going well, but it's another thing to praise him in the middle of the battle. It's another thing to call on him and know he's there when you don't see any evidence that he's around. And this is the faith of Paul. I am persuaded. I've been through enough in my life to realize that God will never be defeated. And if he gifts me, then he will not allow the gift in me to be destroyed. And that's why he brings me through the hard things. He brings me through the devil's attitudes, and he brings me through the attitudes of folk who can't stand to see the anointing of God on your life. You've got to learn to enjoy the anointing in the middle of adversity. You've got to learn how to lift God up in the middle of the enemy's attitudes against you. You've got to learn not to focus on the negative, but stay focused on the power of God and reach the goal that God has placed in your spirit. There are so many times when we feel like backing up and we feel like moving away, and that's when God shows up again and confirms in our spirits that I'm the reason you're here in the first place. And if I'm the reason you're here, beside me there is no other God. That means once I gift you, you will bring to pass everything that I declared. I think a little bit about Jeremiah, and he was really hurt when God allowed Pashur to whip him real good in the temple. And he said to the Lord, he said, Lord, you have deceived me, because I sort of thought it would be easy once I followed your will. I knew I didn't want to do this, but you insisted I do it. Have you ever had a burden that God placed on your heart, and down in your mind you knew that it would be difficult to get it done? Sort of like someone who knows what to do, but but don't want to do it because of the consequences. And so Jeremiah felt, Lord, why should I? Why should I? I don't want to do this, but you insisted. Now I'm in a situation where I'm being derided on all sides. But God would not let him walk away. He turned up the heat in his spirit. And Jeremiah cried, it's like fire shut up in my bones. I am convinced that when God has laid his hands on you, you can't get away from what God wants you to do. So you might as well roll up your sleeves and tell the enemy, I'm gifted and I'm going to do the will of God. Oh, I feel the presence of God in here. Do you feel the anointing of the Lord? When God has laid his hands on you, you can't walk away from God's hand. So let the devil come and let the enemy rise up against you. Let him throw what he's got against you. You're coming out all right. Because the only way for him to stop you is to go back into eternity and stop the choice of God. And there's no devil who can go back into eternity and stop what God has purpose for you to do. So dry your tears. Wipe your face off. Rise out of the ashes and tell the devil, I will do what God told me to do. No matter how the enemy fights me, no matter how he comes after me, understand this, nobody who's doing anything for God is doing it without a fight. We stand and we smile and we give the impression that everything is all right. But let me tell you, for every time we get up to do the will of God, we had to overcome an obstacle of the devil. And when you look in the faces and see the anointing of God, it's because folks have been crushed by satanic attacks on every side. But every time we've been crushed, a little more oil of anointing comes out of our hearts. Every time we've been talked about, every time we've been aligned, every time we've been put in a bad situation by folk who don't want the will of God to be done, another anointing, a fresh move of God is squeezed out of our system. Every time we've had to cry, every time we've had to get deep in prayer, lock our way out of the house into a prayer closet. Can I preach to you just a minute? A prayer closet can become, it started out a cave. I thought about David in the cave of Adullam under the pressure of Saul, and it looked just like a cave, a place to hide away. But every time he would cry out to God, that cave became a prayer closet. And the Hebrew word said, when he cried out and he said, help, the echo came back. Help, help, help. When he cried out, save, the echo came back. Save, save, save. So now not only is he praying to God, but the words are reverberating against the wall. Sometimes you feel the enemy's got you, but when the gift of God stands up in you, there's nothing the enemy can do. I feel the power of God in this house. There is an anointing that will destroy the yoke. And when God puts his hand on you, step in the power of God. And don't look back. Don't turn to the left or the right. But tell the enemy, I'm going forward in the power of the living God. Everything that God has placed in front of me, it's mine for the taking. That's why the word says the kingdom of heaven suffereth violence, and the violent take it by force, and the violent have to be anointed. And when you're gifted, look for the enemy. If you don't want to be blessed, then don't get ready to fight. But if you want to be blessed, get ready to fight for your children, fight for your family, fight for your church, fight for the gift that God has laid in you to bless others all around you. And let the devil know, you got to take me standing, but I am a child of God. And I will not lay down and let you defeat me. But the God that's in me will overcome the world. I feel the Spirit of God here. Somebody ought to give him some praise. Wherever you are, praise him for your victory. Praise him for your strength. Praise him that no devil can stop you from fulfilling the purpose of God. Praise him because you're rising up. I see you're rising up to the place where God told you to go. And I feel you're moving to another level. And the next level is the level where Satan will never be able to get to you. I see him reaching for you now. And God's moving you out of his grip. I see your home coming around. I see your job straightening up. I see prosperity and strength. I see a fresh anointing coming your way because you are guarded. Oh, I want to leave this with you. I'm guarded by God. I'm guarded by his power. You're guarded because you're precious to him. You're guarded because you're a part of the army of the Lord that's going to reduce the devil's kingdom to rubble. This is why this country is attacked, because we're gifted. We're a gift to the world. We're a gift to people that are out there who need the word of God. And the enemy hates the fact that we're gifted. But there is an anointing that the enemy can't do anything with. And I'm so glad he's anointed you. I'm so glad we have an army of folk who can gather together and declare the Lord is on our side. I feel the power of God here. Oh, touch somebody and tell them, I'm guarded. Those of you in the studio, tell them, I'm guarded. Those of you at home, just throw your hands up and say, Lord, I'm glad I'm guarded. I'm glad you've got your hands on me. I'm glad victory shall be mine. It is here then, as I close, that once he has committed this gift to me, there's a couple of things here that are significant. The first is I have to trust him who trusts me. He trusts me with the gift. I have to trust him to keep the gift in me. If he can give me a gift from eternity, then I can trust him to keep the enemy off me while I perform the gift that he gives. If he can trust me with his anointing, I can trust him with my protection. If I can be trusted with healing in my hands, then I can trust him to hold me in his hands. If he can trust me with a word out of my mouth, then I can trust every word that he speaks. And he told me, weeping may endure for a night, but joy cometh in the morning, because I am guarded. I'm guarded by his power. I'm guarded by his word. I'm guarded by his strength. And I will overcome and get through this. And so I send a word of encouragement to every gifted person out there. Hold on to your gift. Don't give up on yourself. Hold on to your God and go forward. Don't go forward in fear, but go forward in the might of the living God. Go forward understanding that no weapon formed against you shall prosper. I feel like shouting in here, but I've got to let this mic go in here tonight. Come on, Bishop. Come on up here. Let's close this thing out. I feel the power of God. Am I guarded or am I guarded? Has God kept you through the storm? He's kept you through the rain. He's kept you through all manner of things. Oh, we're going to pray in a minute, but we glorify God together. We're not going to preach tonight together, but glory be to God. You're looking at guarded, anointed folk, and if you're out there, understand it. He will not let the devil wipe you out. He'll be there because you're guarded.
Come on and put those hands together and give God a prayer.
We're going to pray for every person, for every individual that's out there. We're going to pray.
prayer requests are coming in from everywhere. They're writing from all over the country. Just a handful of prayer requests from all over the world. Needs, sicknesses, conditions, infirmities. They're calling from the hospitals. They're calling, believing God for healings and deliverances, discovering the gifts and the power of God that's in their lives. Sylvia's called in asking God for a miracle. David has called in and said, I need a prayer for a supernatural miracle. Help is on the way for you right now. I want everyone in here to join hands with somebody as Bishop Jones and I agree in prayer together that the Spirit of God could supernaturally do a work in your life. Father, in the name of Jesus, the Bible has said to him whom much is given, much is required. You've invested so much in so many, and many are up under attack right now. But because of your word, we begin to understand that it's because of the gift that's inside of us. Furthermore, we understand that no weapon formed against us shall prosper. We lift up every prayer request and every need before you right now. In the name of Jesus, thank you for sending medicine in the hospital, healing and deliverance, touching people in bereavement, people in distress. Somebody needs salvation in their house tonight. Somebody needs that son delivered off of drugs right now. I thank you for being a miracle worker. Now, devil, we serve notice on you. This is an eviction notice tonight. Pack your grip, brother. You got to go. We bind your powers in the name of Jesus. We cast you out. We cast you out. Out of the finances, out of the family, out of the home, right now, in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for victory, in the name of Jesus. Put those hands together and give God a praise right now. Come on and praise Him. Come on and praise Him. Come on and praise Him. If you believe in miracles, if you believe in deliverance, hallelujah, don't worry about it. Valerie, help is on the way. Get ready, Sylvia. Help is on the way. Sharon, help is on the way. Joseph, get ready. Help is on the way. Bernice, God just heard us calling your name. Robert, here comes help. Mimi, get ready. Deliverance is coming your way. Get ready, Thelma. Get ready, Teresa. Get ready, Jenny. Get ready right now. Mary, we just lifted you up before God. Denise, deliverance is coming to your house. Get ready for it. Shirley, Dolores, we believe in God for you. Miracles are coming your way. Somebody help me praise the Lord up in here. Somebody help me give God glory. Somebody help God, help me praise God for the gift in Bishop Noel Jones. Come on, give God glory tonight. My God, my God, my God. There are miracles in this house right now. There's deliverance in this house right now. Those of you that are in this studio right now, you're not here by mistake. The Spirit of God is here to bless you and to strengthen you and to touch you. And I believe in the name of Jesus that the best is yet to come. Clap your hands and thank God once more, would you? Quickly before we close tonight, I just want to mention to those of you that are praying and believing God, and we've been talking about leadership earlier, and you want to be a part of that conference at Nat Tate and Curtis Wallace, and in this particular one, I'm going to be there too, January the 5th, January the 5th. If you're anywhere near D.C., Washington, D.C., we're going to be at the Constitution Hall in D.C. It is a registered meeting just for pastors and leaders, and if you want to be a part of that leadership conference, you either need to call our 1-800 number or put my website up on there so that they can get a hold to us there. It's going to be a one-day Saturday morning event in Washington, D.C., and so you need to be a part of that. The guest for Atlanta Wednesday night, praise the Lord, November the 28th, is going to be the host is going to be Pastor Richard Hogue from the Church City Church in Oklahoma City. The guests include Lloyd Buster, Dr. Dale Bronner, Prophetess Juanita Bynum. The music is going to be by Steve Brock, and you want to be there and participate as God releases supernatural blessings in your life. Come on and help me praise the Lord for His goodness. Bishop, we thank God for you. Thank God for the gift that you are to the body. God has made you a gift. And not only has God made Bishop, so many times people see us and they say, well, I can see that they're gifted. I can see that he's gifted. I can see that Shirley Murdoch is gifted, Beverly Crawford, or somebody else. But let me tell you something. You're gifted too.
Yes, definitely.
You're gifted too. You have a gift in you. You have That's something right. to give. You have something to do. You've got places to go and people to see. Right. Don't let the enemy have your joy. Don't let him have your peace. He who has begun a good work in you shall perform it unto the day of Jesus Christ. Back up that devil right now in the name of Jesus. Get ready to come out with your hands up. Your deliverance is on the way right now. Somebody help me praise him in here.
Yes.
Praise him in here. Pick up the phone and call our prayer counselors. Get them on the phone right now and call right now. We want to agree in prayer with you. And those of you that still want to pledge to the Praise-a-thon, it's still going on. It's still not too late to be a blessing to TBN. It is a gift to us. Let's support the gift that God has given us. Let's thank God for Trinity Broadcasting Network. Paul and Jan, we love you. We thank God for you. We thank God for what you're doing. And believe me now, no matter what you've been through, the best is yet to come. Everybody in here ought to praise the Lord. Give him glory tonight. We love you. Thank God for you. Hang on in there. Give him glory. Hallelujah. We lift you up. We thank you, Jesus. Nobody like you. Yes.
TBN has a worldwide ministry. We need your love gifts, large or small, to help keep the gospel of Jesus Christ going around the world. So write today. Praise the Lord, P.O. Box A, Santa Ana, California, 92711. Or in Canada, write TBN, P.O. Box 768, Station B, Ottawa, Ontario, A1P 5P8. If you haven't asked Christ into your life, call a prayer partner now and pray to receive Jesus as Savior and Lord. Now until next time, remember to praise the Lord.
This program has been brought to you through the prayers and contributions of our faithful partners throughout North America and the world.